Hello students, welcome back. Myself Pushpendra Singh and we are going to start with our NCERT class. Okay, so today you have the 9th standard geography. Okay, so we are basically studying the different type of the forest sources you have. Okay, and in our last class what we have covered basically the different type of forest. For example, we have covered the tropical rainforest. Okay, we have covered the tropical deciduous forest, in which we have seen that there are two types of the deciduous forest, the moist deciduous forest and the dry deciduous forest. Okay, so these are the basic classifications we have seen. Okay, now let's continue to that. So the next is basically the tropical thorn forest or the scrub. Okay, so what is that tropical thorn forest or the scrub? Basically, these are the forests and the scrubs which are found in those areas where the rainfall is very, very low. Okay, so if the rainfall is less than 70 centimeters or even lesser than that, it is been found in these areas. Okay, now this tropical thorn forest and the scrubs covers 5% of the total forested area of the country. Okay, regarding the region of occurrence, they are found basically in the northwestern part of the country. Specifically, the northwestern part of the country means obviously you have the arid region. Okay, as well as the semi-arid region. Okay, these arid and semi-arid region obviously are found in the Rajasthan adjoining Gujarat and some portions of Uttar Pradesh, Chhattisgarh, Haryana and Madhya Pradesh. Obviously the drier regions of UP, Chhattisgarh, Haryana and MP, the drier regions, right, as well as some of the drier regions of the Deccan Plateau, where you can say that it is basically, you know, the rain shadow area, right? In the rain shadow area also you are basically having this tropical thorn forest and, you know, scrub forest that may be found. Okay, now let's understand the characteristics of this tropical thorn forest or the scrubs. What are the characteristics of tropical thorn forest and the scrub? So first of all, that in the tropical thorn forest, they are not luxurious, they are not very dense. Okay, since they are not very dense, you can understand that they may be scattered. They may be scattered because the most limiting factor in this forest is basically the water. Okay, the water is the most limiting factor. Okay, so because of that, these trees or the forest are basically scattered in the nature. They are found here and there, that too, you know, in a few numbers only, right? So other than plants, we have the long roots, right, succulent stems and the small thick leaves are also found. Why the long roots? Because in search of water, okay, these roots basically goes down as deeper as they can. Okay, the succulent stems basically, you know, help in the storing of water and food, right? They help in the storing of the water and the foods. The smaller thick leaves, basically, you know, help in, right, reducing in the transpiration rate. Okay, the transpiration from the leaves. Okay, they help in the reduction of the transpiration from the leaves, and that is the reason they have these many qualities. Okay, now all of these characteristics have developed to minimize the evaporation. Okay, obviously the evaporation or the transpiration loss, and to conserve the moisture. The only scrubs are found in the desert areas with the least rainfall. Okay, because you don't have the sufficient amount of moisture, and because of that only scrubs you will be found over there, right? Specifically in the desert areas you may found the cactus or the thorny varieties of the forest, right? Regarding the flora and the fauna, flora means the type of flowers or flowering plants or the trees. Okay, fauna means the type of the life form or animals which are found basically over there, right? So most of the trees are acacia palm, right? The cactus are found over these areas. Regarding animals, the fox, wolf, rats, mice, wild ass, horses, tiger, lion, camels and other animals are also found in the drier portions of the desert region. Okay, let's understand the new type of forest, that is mountain forest. Okay, now why it is called mountain forest? Because it is being generally found in the elevated portion, or it is been found in certain, you know, altitude, right, at some altitude, specifically in the mountainous region. So that is the reason it is called as mountain forest. So these forests are basically covering the portions of the Himalayas, okay, as well as the portions of certain other mountainous region. So these forests cover around 17% of the total forested area of the country, okay, and they are found mainly in the mountainous regions. So obviously the mountains, where are the mountains? The Himalayas basically flow, you know, from Jammu and Kashmir, from Himachal, Uttarakhand, Sikkim and Arunachal Pradesh, right? So we have, you know, the most of these mountainous regions, right, or the mountainous forest regions are basically in the Jammu and Kashmir, Himachal, Uttarakhand, Sikkim and your Himachal Pradesh. Okay, now the natural vegetation or the vegetation which is found in this area depends on the altitude, okay? So obviously the vegetation also changes with the altitude. As the altitude change, as you move from, you know, from the bottom to up, right, in the elevated portion, suppose this is a hill or Himalaya, okay, the vegetation also changes over there. The vegetation also changes over there because there is a changes in the temperature conditions, there are changes in the moisture conditions, right, that the changes in the environmental conditions, so the natural vegetation also changes accordingly. Okay, now the succession of the natural vegetation belt is in the same order from the tropical to the tundra vegetation. Okay, that we are going to study now. What are the succession of the natural vegetation, specifically as you move from, you know, from the bottom to the top of your mountainous region, how the vegetation will be changing, how the vegetation basically changes in this region. Okay, so next, understand the altitudinal distribution of the mountain forest. What are the altitudinal distribution of the mountain forest? That means how there is a variation of, there is a variation of the, you know, the vegetation, okay, with altitude, with altitude. So this is basically the altitudinal distribution of the mountain forest. So first of all, the wet temperate forests are found at the lower altitude. That means in the altitude between 1000 to 2000 meter, you have the wet temperate forest, because here you will have, you know, the sufficient amount of the rainfall. Okay, so here you will find the evergreen broadleaf trees, okay, because of the sufficient amount of moisture and sufficient amount of, you know, the temperature. So these evergreen broadleaf trees are basically oaks, chestnuts are basically found in the elevation of 1000 to 2000 meters, right? Then in the altitude of 1500 to 3000 meter, you have basically mainly the temperate forest. Okay, now these temperate forests which are found in these regions are basically coniferous. Okay, coniferous, which is in the shape of this one, you might have seen also. Okay, so they are in the shape, and these trees are basically, you know, pine, deodar, silver fir, spruce, cedar are some of the temperate forests which have been found over there. Okay, and these temperate forests are basically found in the southern slope of the Himalayas, because the Himalayas orientation, the Himalayas orientation in such a way that the sun basically, you know, having, or the southern face, this, let's say this is southern face, so this southern face have, you know, the, you know, the basically abundant sunshine. Okay, because of abundant sunshine which is basically available at the southern face of the Himalaya, okay, it is the reason this you know, the temperate forests are found on the southern slopes, having high altitude in the southern and northeastern India. Okay, now regarding temperate grasslands, these temperate grasslands are found basically in the higher elevations. Okay, if you move above than 3000 meters above, okay, beyond your temperate forest, right, roughly over the altitude of 3600 meters above, right, mean sea level, you will have, you know, the grasslands. This gives, right, and after that, after 3600 meters above, you will have the alpine vegetation. Okay, so up to 3600 meters you will have the temperate grasslands, and beyond you have the alpine vegetation, right? The alpine vegetation are basically in the form of shrubs, in the form of scrub, because the limitation is in terms of the availability of the water. Okay, now these areas are extensively used by the nomadic tribes, right? The nomadic tribes basically, you know, are the nomads which move from one place to the another place in search of pasture, in search of the pasture with their animals, right? So the Gujjars and the Bakarbal in the Jammu and Kashmir, Himachal Pradesh and Uttarakhand region, they basically move with their herd of animals, right, from the lower reaches to the higher reaches of the Himalaya, specifically to those alpine vegetation, right, to have, you know, the pasture land for their animals. So they are continuously in the move, so they are called the nomadic tribes. Then after that you will have the tundra vegetation. The tundra vegetation where you will have, you know, basically the mosses and the lichens, okay, and they are found at the higher altitudes of the Himalaya, at the higher altitudes of the Himalaya in the form of moss and the lichens. Okay, regarding flora and the fauna, the flora and the fauna in these regions are basically, the flora means type of trees or the type of vegetation, fauna means the type of animal species which are found over there. Okay, regarding animals, the Kashmir stag, spotted deer, wild sheep, jack rabbit, Tibetan antelope, yak, snow leopard, squirrel, the shaggy horn, wild ibex, bear, rare red panda, sheep, goats, right, with a thick hair have been found over there, because obviously, right, with the altitude you will also have the temperature variations also. Regarding the trees or the flora, you will have the silver firs, pines, juniper, birches are some of the trees which are commonly found in this region. Okay, next, understand the mangrove forest. What are the mangrove forest? See, the mangrove forest are basically found in the deltaic region. Okay, the deltaic region, because these trees are basically, you know, are generally inundated under the water. Okay, a certain portion of the trees basically below the water, and they are projected above the water. That means they are located in the inside the water, their roots are inside the water, generally they are submerged in the water, and the certain portion of the trees is basically emerged out of the water, and they have the different, you know, the adaptation features. For example, they have new metaphors, they have, you know, the propped roots, right, through which they basically takes the oxygen and other, you know, other carbon dioxide and other gases, you know, particles, right, from the air for their sustenance. So these are found basically in the coastal delta regions, which are influenced by the sea tides. Okay, and they are also called the tidal forest, because the portion of the plant is basically, you know, are submerged under the water, and the portion of the trees are basically above the water. Okay, the roots is basically predominate, the mangroves are submerged under the water. Okay, always they are submerged under the water, so they are always in the certain adaptation features, right? And such forests are mainly found in the deltaic regions. For example, you will have the deltas of Ganga, Brahmaputra, Mahanadi, Godavari, Krishna, Kaveri. Okay, in these deltas you will have the mangrove forest, because the rivers basically brought, you know, lot of silt, along with that lot of mud which are brought down by the rivers, okay, in this region, and they are basically in the form of, you know, this type of mangrove forest which are basically found in this region, in this region. All right, next. Okay, regarding the flora and the fauna, so if you consider the Ganga Brahmaputra delta, you will find mainly the Sundari trees, and against that you will have the name called Sundarbans, because the predominant trees are basically Sundari. Okay, which provide also, right, the durable timber, right, which is basically having the tremendous applications in the industries, right? And, you know, other trees which are found, for example, palm trees, coconut trees, keura and agar are also found in this region. The animals found basically are Royal Bengal tigers, snakes, turtles, gharials, and the crocodiles, which are found in this region. Okay. Regarding the wildlife, so regarding wildlife, first of all, India is, you know, very richly endowed in terms of the fauna or in terms of the animal life. Okay. And as well as in the floral life or in the plant life. Okay. Lot of species are endemic in India that are only found in India. So in terms of the richness of the flora and fauna, right, India has approximately 90,000 animal species, right? These 90,000 animal species are found in India, and you have 2,000 world species are also found in India. Okay. If you consider in the world stock, that is around 13% of the total world population. Okay. And India is also endowed with 2,546 species of the fish, which are accounting to around 12% of the world known fish species in the world. Okay. Then India is also share in terms of, if you want to have the, in terms of the amphibians, reptiles and the mammals. So India has roughly between 5 to 8% of the world amphibians, reptiles and the mammals. Okay, so obviously the existence of the animal vary from place to place. It depends on the climatic conditions. It depends on the adaptability of the animals. Okay, which are also the most important parameter of the sustenance of any species, whether it is a plant species or whether it is animal species. So the adaptability to the climate, adaptability to the particular environment, the suitability to the particular environment is the most important parameter related to the wildlife, whether it is the animal life or whether it is the plant life. Okay, so this is the most important parameter which are supposed to be there. Okay, now let's understand about the distribution of the wildlife in India. Okay, so regarding the distribution of the wildlife in India, right, so as you know that there are different type of animals which are found. Okay, the elephant, if you consider, the elephant are the most majestic animal which are found among the mammals. Okay, they are found specifically in the forest of Assam, Karnataka and the Kerala. These are the three states where the elephants are in higher density, in the higher numbers. Then you have the one horn rhinoceros. Okay, that one horn rhinoceros are, you know, the animal which is generally found in the swampy region, in the marshy region, which are mainly found in the Assam and the West Bengal region. Okay, then you have, you know, specifically, you know, the wild ass and the camel and camels. These wild ass and the camels are basically found in the Thar desert, right, and the runoff Kutch region respectively. Okay. And in India also you will found, right, both the tigers and the lions also. Okay, so here you will have the tigers and the lions also. Okay, and the natural habitat of the Indian lions is basically, you know, the Gir forest. Okay, so the Gir forest is located in the Gujarat, where the Indian lions or Asiatic lions are basically found. Okay, the tigers are found in the different states, for example, in the Madhya Pradesh, in the Sundarbans of West Bengal, in the Himalayan region, the tigers are found. Okay, then the leopards too are the members of the cat family. Okay, these leopards are basically found, you know, in the different regions, and they are important animals of prey. Okay, so they are also considered as the predator. Okay, next. The Himalayan harbor the hardy range of animals which survive in the extreme cold. So depending on the adaptability of the animals, we have seen, right, we have seen in the mountainous region, we have different type of animals or different type of, you know, the fauna, which is basically the animal life is found in this Himalayan belt. Okay, now this fauna having the different adaptability features with the different environmental conditions, which can survive in the extremity of the cold also. Okay, now this Ladakh freezing high altitude are home to the yak. So yak is found in the Ladakh region, which is, you know, very high altitude, you know, it is just like cold desert, right? The shaggy horned wild ox, specifically, you know, weighting the ton, around 1 ton of the weight is also found, right? Then Tibetan antelope, then blue sheep, wild sheep, and you have the Tibetan wildlife are some of the fauna are basically found in this Leh Ladakh region. Then you have the ibex, bear, snow leopard, and very rare red panda also found in the certain pockets of the high altitudinal region. Okay, in the lakes, rivers, and the coastal areas, you will have the turtles, crocodiles, and the gharials, which are found. Okay, and the gharial is the only representative of the crocodile which are found in the world today. So in the gharial population in India is also very high. Okay, the world life is different type of world species are also found in India, as you know. Okay, so world life is colorful in India. So you have different type of birds, for example, peacock, all of you knows, the peasants, ducks, right, parakeets, cranes, different type of cranes are there. Then you have the pigeons, right? These are some of the beautiful birds that are found in the wetland or in the forest regions of the country. Okay, then you have the different animals which are found in the different areas, right? For example, you have the Indian bison. Okay, then you have the Nilgai or blue bull. Okay, then you have the Chausinga, which is the four-horned antelope. Okay, then you have gazelle, and the different species of the deer are also found, okay, in India in the different places. Okay, and India is also having the several species of the monkeys, okay, which are also found in the different parts of the country also. Regarding migratory birds, so migratory birds are those birds which migrate from, you know, some region. So that is the source region, that is the source region. Okay, so you have the migratory birds, which are mainly, you know, the migrate, you know, from the source region. So you have the origin, okay, and you have basically the destination. Okay, so from the origin, the migratory birds basically, you know, originate or they move and they basically reaches to some other region. All right, so these are some of the migratory birds which are found in the different region. For example, you have the Siberian cranes. Okay, these Siberian cranes basically, you know, move from the Siberia, which is basically very cold, specifically during the winter, and they migrate, right, to some portions of India. Okay, so for example, they migrate from the basically the Siberia to the Keulaudeo National Park, which is basically located in Bharatpur. Okay, the Bharatpur, Rajasthan. Okay, now some of the wetlands which are popular for these migratory birds, specifically during winter, when the Siberian cranes comes in the large numbers. So the Siberian cranes basically comes to the Keulaudeo National Park, which is located in the Bharatpur district of Rajasthan, right? One other place which is favorable for the birds are basically Run of Kutch. That in the Run of Kutch region also, the different bird life is also found. Okay, then at a place where the desert merges with the sea. Okay, so it is basically, you have, you know, the flamingo, which is basically, you know, with their brilliant pink plumage, right, there comes in the thousand to build a nest over there, specifically in the salty mud, and raise their young ones. And what happens is they come and they raise their young ones, and once they become old, they basically go back with their younger one. Okay, and they are one among the many extraordinary sites, okay, which are there in our country, which are famous for these migratory birds. Okay, now why we need the environmental conservation? That is the most important topic. Now we must understand the environmental conservation is needed because without conserving the environment, we cannot sustain, right? We are dependent on the environment for our sustenance, right? Various flora and the fauna, right? Various plant species, right? The animal species are dependent on the environment for their survival, okay? You have seen that different species have gone extinct, right? And different species are at the verge of extinction, okay? So if you want to save, if you want to save those species from being getting extinct, okay, you need to have the protection of the environment. You need to conserve the environment, okay, and that will be beneficial, right, not only for the human survival but also for the animal and the plant survival also. Okay, now if you how do you conserve your environment? The point is that you can conserve your environment, okay, by sustainable development. Okay, that is something which is most required. So the sustainable development is the process or is the development in which, you know, the development in such a way that when you consume the resources, you will be using the resources in such a way that it should be sufficient for the future generation also, right? You should not use it in such a way that it is basically exhaustive in the nature, and it should be in such a way that it should also fulfill the demands and the need of the future generation also. So our crops basically consist of the edible plants from biodiverse environment. Okay, now different medicinal plants are also we use. Okay, now if the environment is not conserved, right, from where we will get the edible plants, from where we will get these medicinal plants? So it is for our benefit, right, for our sustenance, for our food sources, okay, for our medicinal sources, right, we need to conserve the environment. Then the animals are selected from the large stock provided by the nature, which are milch animals, which provide, you know, the milk, right, which are also provide the, you know, the draught power, transportation, meat and eggs. So obviously, you know, the cow is basically poor man's the resources, specifically in the drought prone regions. So they provide much needed avenues of the resources for the poor people, specifically in the drought prone region. They also provide the avenues for the transportation. You would have seen the bullock carts. Okay, they also provide the meat and eggs also, so which are also needed for the human survival. The fish are also provide the nutritive food, right? Many insects basically help in the pollination of the crops and the fruit trees. When you retard or when you degrade this environment, that will also affect these insects, and ultimately the pollination will get affected. And once the pollination will get affected, obviously the crops and the fruit trees will also getting affected. Okay, they also exert the biological control on the insects which are harmful. Okay, now every species has role to play in the ecosystem. So that is, you know, every species have role to play in the food web, in the food chain. Once you remove that particular species, your entire food chain and the food web will get affected. Okay, so in order to have, right, the proper sustenance in the environment, you need to protect all species. Every species have their role to play. Okay, now due to the excessive exploitation of the plants and the animals, okay, the ecosystem is getting disturbed. You might have seen also now the degradation of the environment is going on. For example, you will have the different type of pollution. Okay, you will have the pollution. For example, you have, you know, the soil pollution, you have the water pollution, you have the air pollution. Okay, you have, you know, different types of pollutions are there. Okay, you have the noise pollution, you have the environmental degradation, right? So these pollutions are basically affecting, you know, the environment. Okay, ultimately the environment is getting degraded. Okay, around 1300 plant species are basically endangered, and 20 species are extinct, and many such species are going to extinct in the future also, right? So if we want to conserve those species from getting extinct, okay, Now, you need to protect the environment also, right? And there are quite a few animal species which are endangered and some have become already extinct. So if you want to conserve those species, you need to conserve the environment. Now, look at this map. This map basically shows you know, the different wildlife sanctuary, world sanctuary, and the national park which has been there. So you can see here the round one, the black round, which is basically shown by, you know, wildlife sanctuary. Then star is showing the world sanctuary, and the triangle, you know, the black triangle is showing the national parks. So you can find out these different, you know, the wildlife sanctuary, world sanctuary, and the national parks in India. For example, you have the Dachigam, you know, national park. You have Rajaji National Park. You have Corbett National Park. You have Dudhwa National Park. Okay, then you have the Sariska Wildlife Sanctuary. Then you have Kewlaudeo National Park, which is in the Rajasthan. Then you have Ranthambore National Park, again in the Rajasthan, Sawai Madhopur district. Then you have Gir National Park, which is in Gujarat. Then you have the Sanjay Gandhi National Park. Then you have the Kawal, you know, Wildlife Sanctuary. Then you have Pocharam Wildlife Sanctuary. Okay, then you have the Rangatitu, you know, basically your the world sanctuary. Then you have Bandipur Wildlife Sanctuary, okay, Bandipur National Park. Then you have the Madhumalai, you know, your wildlife sanctuary. Then you have the Guindy, you know, National Park, which is located in Chennai. Then you have Ithumangram, which is a wildlife sanctuary. Then you have the Chandaka Dempara, which is again a wildlife sanctuary. Then you have the Simlipal, which is a national park. Then Kanha, which is a national park. Then Tadova, which is a national park. Then Rajgir, which is a national park, right? Chandraprabha, which is a wildlife sanctuary, okay? Shivpuri, which is a national park, okay? Then you have the Mahanadi, which is basically a wildlife sanctuary, okay? Then you have Gorumara, which is basically a national park. Then you have Manas, which is a national park. Then you have the Kaziranga, which is again a national park, okay? So there are different national parks which are found. So you can easily find out the different national parks, wildlife sanctuaries which are scattered in the different parts of the country. India has, you know, declared the certain, you know, the protected areas as the wildlife sanctuary, as the national parks. Okay. Now these wildlife sanctuaries and the national parks are basically some of, you know, the regions which are protected under, you know, Wildlife Protection Act, right? And these have been given different range of protection. For example, the national parks have been given the highest range of the protection, right? Then again, the forest have been classified as a, you know, the reserve forest, you know, protected forest. Okay, you have the wildlife sanctuaries, right, where different range of the protection is being given to the wildlife species. All right, so we are going to wind up today our session, because now the next is basically your population. So it is a population geography is the next topic. So we'll continue this thing in the next topic. So today we have completed your environmental geography, that is a part of your geography. Okay, we have completed, you know, the different varieties of the forest. You have the rainforest, tropical deciduous forest, in which you have the moss deciduous, dry deciduous. We have seen the thorn forest. Okay, we have also seen, you know, montane forest. We have also seen, you know, the deltaic forest, or, you know, your mangrove forest. Okay, so different type of forest resources we have seen, their most important characteristics we have seen, the flora and the faunal composition also we have seen. Okay, and we have also seen how the with the altitude the vegetation basically varies with the altitude. We have also seen that one. Okay, and we are just finished off, you know, the environmental conservation. So from tomorrow or to tomorrow's class, we will continue with our population geography, which is your next chapter. So this thing will continue in the tomorrow's class. All right. So thank you very much for those students who have attended this class. Thank you very much.